to church this morning. It is sunny and we are happy you are here. So why don't you stand up and join with us? To see you all on this beautiful sunny day. I'm Abby, and for those of you who don't know me, my husband and I, Brad, go here, and we're foster parents, and I think God knows what he's doing when he asks people to serve him and worship him, because after 14 months in our home, exactly 421 days, our two foster babies are going home on Friday. And while our hearts are full of joy that God has restored their family, we're grieving. And the loss in our family is pretty deep, you know, and we have a lot of fear. We have a lot of fear of what's next. You know, what's God going to ask us to do? What's his plan? And, you know, we wonder, are we going to say no to the right placement or yes to the wrong placement? But I'm learning this week I was talking to my mom and I was crying and she said, "You're giving yourself too much responsibility." She said, "God is going to do what he wants to, no matter what decision you make." And it hit me, like, he really is. It doesn't really matter what I do, I'm along for the ride. He's going to make happen what he wants happen. And he's been speaking to me a lot this week through Jeremiah. Jeremiah 29, where it says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you. You will seek me and find me. When you seek me with all of your heart, I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will restore." So God, I pray today we will be in this space and seek you with all of our heart. So just be ready to surrender and join with us as we sing our next song.
Savior's robe as he walks into the room where people pray, where we hear praises, he is faith. The Savior's robe as he walks into the room where people pray, where we hear worship, he hears faith.
Of his people on their knees, awake. thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard a tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. And I've seen many searching for answers, far but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are, yeah. It's who you are. It's who you are. Call me deeper still as you call. are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Nice. God, you are our good, good Father. We just worship you this morning and proclaim the fact that every word we sing, you are all of those things. You're perfect in all your ways. You're perfect in all your ways. You have love that we can't deny. You bring peace. You watch over us. God, we love you so much. We just lift up this morning. We pray that through the next song and the teaching and then the song after that and anything that else is going on today could just be focused into focus in on you, make you greater. And God, we're just so thankful for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
People. Christ. Amen. Stay up while we read our scripture today.
Good morning, all. We are the Brabsons, Clarence and Mary. We have called Eagle our family home for over 25 years, and we also host a small group in our homes on Sunday evening.
Thank you. If you're not standing, please stand for the word of the Lord. Our teaching text today is from Ephesians 5, 1 through 8. Be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love. Just as Christ loved us and gave us himself up for us in a fragrant offering and a sacrifice to God. But among you, there must not be even a hint of sexual immorality or even a kind of impurity or greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. Nor should there be any obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse joking, which are out of place, but rather thanksgiving. For of this you can be sure, no moral, impure, or greedy person, such a man is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of such things God's wrath comes on those who are disobedient. Therefore, do not be partners with them. For you once was in darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of the light. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
For us to be together. If you're joining us online, welcome. Your host will get you all that you need. If there's sermon notes that you can download and all. But this morning I want to give a congratulations to the Bryant family, Travis and Hannah, as in the birth of their son, Jaden Clint Raleigh Bryant. Mom and Jaden are doing well. He was born on February 22nd. Travis and big brothers Ben and Graham are doing well, but be praying for them. That's a house. As you know, you get two and you add a third, mom and dad are outnumbered. So they're learning zone defense now and how all that works. So just be praying, but we are thrilled and overjoyed for the Bryant household. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. The topic that we're talking on this morning is not an easy one. I have sensed just the enemy does not want this preached this morning, which just confirms God does. So I want to pray that I get out of his way and find my way back down to my seat and allow God to do his thing. Father, we do invite you. We are thrilled that you are here, yet you really need no invitation. And Father, I pray that you would open your word to us in fresh and new ways. Father, may your spirit have his way in this place. The enemy has no place here, has no voice here. So, Father, may your angels move among us, quieting the enemy that we would hear only your spirit. Father, allow them to not hear me, but to hear you. Open your heart, open your word to us as we open our hearts and our minds to you. In Jesus' name, amen. We have been talking about the life of Paul these last several, I guess probably months now at this point, on his missionary travels, his teachings. We've been all over the Mediterranean Sea. We've been three missionary journeys, churches that have been planted all along the way. And we have been the last few weeks in Ephesus, focusing on the Ephesian church and the letter that Paul wrote. Paul visited them on his third missionary journey, but now is writing this letter actually from prison in Rome and writing out to several of the churches that he had planted. So if you remember, let's just kind of do a quick review. Ephesians chapter 1, we talked about a love supreme where God the Father chooses us. He adopts us. And that his Son, God the Son, Jesus Christ, redeems us. It was his willingness to go to the cross and shed his blood and be a sacrifice for our sin. And then the Holy Spirit, as we accept Christ, as we place our faith in him, the Holy Spirit comes and seals us or confirms that adoption in us, that we are his, that we are his beloved children. And then we found that God not only saved us individually, but then he takes and he places us in this incredible community called Christ's body, the church. And that we have a role to play. We have a community of believers, a kind of a new family that Jesus has placed us in. And then right in the middle of this letter, he pauses and lets them know how he's praying for them and how he prays for us. I mean, this would be the same prayer that we would pray for one another, that we as being set apart, that we experience his strength, that we experience his love, and that we experience the fullness of who Jesus is. Because then he's going to take us into describing what this body is to look like. And we've done that the last 2 weeks. Eric has led us and taught us on what the church that Jesus longs for. What kind of body does he want? And emphasize a united body, one that we've been placed here in unity and serving. And then last week, maturity. And now in chapter 5, he's going to pick up on that and take us the rest of this letter, chapters 5 and chapter 6, is really zeroing in on what does maturity look like? What does that mature believer look like? Or what does the follower that Christ longs for look like? Clarence and Mary read for you these first 8 verses that we're going to look at, and he starts right off with, therefore be imitators of God. Well, that's not, you know, daunting at all, is it? That word is actually mimetes in the Greek, and if you kind of can get a picture of it, it's the word mimic. And that we are to be mimics of God. That what God does, we mimic. We copy. We live out what he does. Now, what a command that is. That's a pretty high bar, is it not? To mimic God? I just want to tell you this morning, too high for me. I can't do that on my own. You can't do that on your own. In fact, it seems impossible, so hold on, because this could be very discouraging for the next 30 or so minutes as we talk about what it means to be an imitator of God, and at every turn go, I can't do that. That's not me. I don't have that in me. There's good news at the end, so just hold tight. Because passages like this can be discouraging, can be defeating, can be the type where we just throw our hands up and go, I can't do that. It's like me when I say, you know, I want to be a better golfer. Not a chance at 58. I've been playing golf for 46 years. I'm not going to get any better than I am right now. Probably only going to get worse. But it's like if I say I want to be a better golfer and someone says, well, just mimic Tiger Woods. Just do what he does. Well, okay, I wish you'd told me that when I was 12, although Tiger was 1 when I was 12 and he hadn't actually picked up a golf club yet. But that's kind of what it feels like sometimes to mimic God, be imitators of God. We start this text in chapter 5 with that word, therefore. Therefore, be imitators of God. And anytime that a text starts with therefore, you have to look and see what the therefore is there for. And so that requires us to kind of jump back to what he's just said at the end of chapter 4. Paul has established a pattern in this letter of building on what he said before. In fact, he uses that word therefore 15 times in this letter. And so it's always important to know where we've just come from, what we've just come out of. And so in this, Paul says in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 17 to 32, is all talking about how a follower of Christ is to live, how we are to walk, okay, what our walk should look like, what our life should look like. And I'm not going to read all 17 through 32 because I think it's kind of all summed up in verse 24. Chapter 4, verse 24 says this. Let me read 21. And that you be renewed in the spirit of your mind and put on the new self, which in the likeness of God has been created in righteousness and holiness of the truth. To put on the new self. That's created in the likeness of God. It's that whole idea that when salvation comes, we are a new creation. A new person, and this new self that we put on, this new self that God has given us, is in the likeness of God in righteousness and holiness and truth. So when he says, therefore be imitators of God, he's simply saying, be holy as God is holy. So if you thought the bar was high, it just got really high at this point. Because our first imitation of God is his holiness, and this is really nothing new. Throughout the Old Testament, this idea of being holy as God is holy is repeated over and over and over. If you've been reading along in the daily plan, daily Bible reading plan, this last week we finished Leviticus. It's a tough one to get through, although then we just jumped into Numbers, so that's not any better, although you can scroll through all of the names that are just letters, vowels, and consonants jammed together and make no sense. But throughout Leviticus, a number of times, Leviticus chapter 11, Leviticus chapter 19, Leviticus chapter 20, he says, be holy as I am holy. That he must take this serious because he says it throughout the Old Testament. And then Peter picks up on it and reiterates this in his letter in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 14. He says, as obedient children, do not be conformed to the former lusts which were yours in your ignorance, but like the Holy One who called you, be holy yourselves also in all your behavior, because it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. What does it mean for God to be holy? What does it mean for us to be holy as he is holy? That Hebrew word is kadosh. And it kind of has a two-prong understanding that we got to get the full picture of what holiness is. One of them is that it's the idea of being separated from something. Holiness is being separated from sin. Okay? Not bumping into it, not carrying it around with us, separated. You think God cannot exist, or sin cannot exist in the presence of God. He is totally separated. There is no sin in him. There's not even a hint, not even an idea that it could be there. Separated from something, but also set apart for something. So this idea of holiness is that we are separated from sin and set apart for God. To bring him glory, to reflect his glory, to live out his life, his holiness in our life, to be kind of that reflection of him, that when people see us, they get an idea of who he is. We're imitators, we're mimics. A.W. Tozer said, the horrible travesty we have in America today is Christianity without holiness. Now, you have to understand, Tozer died in the 1960s. I don't know that the church has gotten any better at this. At this idea of being separated from sin and set apart for him. The idea that we can have Christ and live like the world is a lie that too many of us believe today. that I can grab on to Christ, but I don't have to really let go of the things of my old life that I liked. Somehow this thinking has seeped in to the life of the church, and we end up with lives of believers that are not all that different from lives of unbelievers. But when I read this, and let me tell you, you're hearing it for the first time. I've been hearing it for about 2 weeks from God. I've done more confessing in the last 2 weeks. Because when we are confronted with this idea that we are to be different, set apart, separated, that the church so often is mimicking the world rather than mimicking God. That how different is my life from the way it was or the way the world is? How different is the way I think? Do I stand in contrast? God's holiness provides us the pattern for us to mimic. And that's an incredibly high bar. Perfection. God is perfectly and wholly separated from sin. We're to mimic that. We're to be imitators of that. So Paul is saying here at the end of chapter 4, the way to do that is put off the old self. The dead in sin self. We talked about that back in chapter 2, that you are dead in your transgressions and sin. Put that old self away. Put that old life away. Render it dead. We talked about that in Romans chapter 6. And put on the new self. The made alive in Christ self. And this is not a self, it's the life God gives us. It's the righteousness that is Christ that he places upon us. Live out of that. Live from that. Put off, Paul says in verse 25, put off lying. Pick up truth and love. Put off unresolved anger. Put on resolved conflict. Put off stealing. Put on earn a living. Put off corrupt speech. Put on encourage, build up. Put off bitterness. Put on kindness, tender, forgiving. Now listen to this, and I love this because we don't often get this aspect when we just read the verses. But that put off, that verb put off, is the type of verb that is a one and done. Put it off, kill it, dead. That we can take and we can kill that old life, we can put it off, we can render it useless, lifeless, separated. And then that put on is not a one and done. That put on is a continuous. It's wake up every morning, put it on. Walk out your door, put it on. Check yourself before you go. Make sure it's on. Throughout the day, put it on. It's a continuous putting on this new self that is ours in Christ. It's this continuous putting on the righteousness that is ours through Christ. It's the continuous putting on that renders the old self powerless. But have you ever got up in the morning and put on the new self, and when you came home from work, you had the old self on, and you're not real sure what happened? Somewhere along the day, you just kind of fell back into old ways of thinking, old ways of behavior. Put off, one and done. Put on continually. Tozer again says, whatever is in my life that is unlike God and contrary to the holiness of God must be eliminated from my life. Now that there's nothing profound in that. That's the whole idea of putting off and putting on. that whatever I find in my life that is old, that is not, is contrary to God and contrary to his holiness, and is going to not be imitators of him but imitators of the world, needs to be eliminated. Dead. Rendered powerless. Get this picture. The cartoon with the devil on one shoulder, the angel on the other. That's really the wrong picture. Because put off means put off, gone, not there. We don't listen anymore. Put on means that now we are focused upon Christ and who he is, and putting him on. In that, the devil is silenced. Now, we know he isn't gone because you and I both know that that voice still chirps in our ears, doesn't it? We still get those ideas. We still are tempted to think that way. Temptation and lies are with us. Look at verse 20, 23 of chapter 4. It says, "But you did not learn Christ in this way. If indeed you have heard him and have been taught in him, just as truth is in Jesus, that in reference to your former manner of life, you lay aside the old self, which is being corrupted in accordance with the lusts of deceit, and that you be renewed in the spirit of your mind." Renewed in the spirit of your mind. That you now think different. You now have the ability to think different. Here's the good news in all of this. You have the ability to put off the old self. You have the ability to live in the newness of Christ. As struggle as it might be, as hard fought some days as it is, when you before had no hope, Christ now gives you hope. That there is a transformation of the mind, a transformation of the way I think, transformation of my worldview. God tells us how we should think about certain things. The Worldview Foundations class that's been going on for the last several weeks, it's a 13, 14 week, but we kind of broke it up over the holidays. They have one more week left, but that whole process, that whole class is really designed to help us begin to think the way God thinks about things that we don't even necessarily know that God thinks about or cares about. My job. Does God care about my job? Yeah, he does. God has a whole design for how labor should work. Learned about that today. God has a whole design on how family should work. God has a whole design on how government should work. God has a whole design on how church should work. And we need to find ourselves thinking about those things the way God does, and that's going to take a transformation. That's what transformation and conforming is all about. It's that change. Because if I'm going to mimic God, if I'm going to be an imitator of God, there's going to need to be a lot of changes in my life. On a daily. Every morning. Because until Jesus comes, that old self, even though while we render it dead, we know practically, experientially, it's not completely dead. As we learn Christ, Paul is saying here, as we learn Christ, as we build on this new relationship with God, as we are involved in study, you know, there are new actions we take on. We take on study, we take on prayer, we take on fasting, we take on silence, we take on solitude, we take on Sabbath. All of these spiritual disciplines, new, and as we involve ourselves in them, as we give our life to them, we find that that relationship with Jesus builds and builds and builds, and we begin to think like him, we begin to understand what he is saying. And while the old self is not completely silenced, that devilish voice in my head gets a little quieter. Jesus said in his illustration of him being the good shepherd, that he said, "The sheep hear my voice. They recognize my voice." And that as we pour ourselves, as we dive into this relationship with God and into these spiritual disciplines and the things that we need to do, this newness of life, we begin to distinguish truth from a lie. And it's a lot easier to flick that devil off your shoulder when you can say, nope, that's not true. I know that's not true. Jesus is our shepherd, our good shepherd. We are the sheep, and the sheep hear his voice. The sheep can distinguish his voice. But if we don't ever spend any time with the shepherd, we're not going to distinguish his voice. It's just going to be one of many out there in the world. Holiness, a separation from sin, and a set apart for God. Therefore, be imitators of God. He goes on to say, therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children and walk in love just as Christ loved you and gave himself up for us. So now in love, in holiness, it's be holy as I am holy, God says. And now in love, it's kind of love as Jesus loves. The bar didn't get any lower. Christ has offered himself to God for us, that we then offer ourselves to God for Christ. It's a personal sacrifice. It's laying myself at his feet. Since Jesus gave his life as a sacrifice for our sins so that we can have a relationship with God, our life is to be a living sacrifice for God, which comes from the love we have for him. We live out of that love. We live from that love. We walk in the love that is the heart of our relationship. We mimic God's love to the world. His love for us to the world. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Therefore, I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. Do not conform to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. A love for God results in worship of God, and that is connected to the life of holiness. That it is this spiritual worship, this connectedness, this holy sacrifice of laying of our body before him, taking on the new that enables us to worship. Unbelievers don't have the ability to worship because they don't have the relationship. Unbelievers can sing, they can't worship. There's a difference. We need to understand that difference, that our love for God results in worship. Wayne Grudem says, if we are truly to draw near to God in worship, there must be a striving for personal holiness of life. The author of Hebrews reminds believers to strive for the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. And Jesus says that it is the pure in heart who shall see God, a promise that is fulfilled partially in this life, completely in the age to come. It is a striving for holiness that allows us to enter into worship. Enter into something that goes beyond singing. Enter into that relationship of acknowledging worth to God. That's worship. Our worship, our love of God, our lifestyle of peace with all others is all connected to this lifestyle of holiness. This ability to love is connected to the be holy as I am holy, to love as I love. Walking in God mimics God. Walking in love mimics God. We can't have the things of God while we remain living like the world. Look at verse 3 of chapter 5. Immorality, impurity, greed, not even named among you. NIV, as the Brabsons read, says not even a hint of sexual immorality, not even a hint of impurity, not even a hint of greed should ever be mentioned about the church, ever. Paul's saying these verses describe the world you were saved out of. What holiness demands we put off. And now, motivated out of a love for God, we live. We conduct our lives in the same way that Jesus did for us. Husbands are given this incredibly high demand, this incredibly high charge to love their wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. We say that at weddings. I remind husbands, that's your role in premarital counseling. I'm reminded every day I'm not very good at it. It's a high standard. It's a high bar. To love someone the way that Christ, to love my wife the way that Christ loved the church. But now we're saying that we're to love the world the way Christ loved the world. Wives, you're not off the hook. Singles, you're not off the hook. To love unbelievers, to love the world, the one captive of sin, the same way as Christ loved us when we were unbelievers, captives of sin. Love requires sacrifice. I'm going to have to give something up to love the world. I'm going to have to give something up to love Jesus with all my heart. And what I give up is the old self. The stuff that's going to tear me down, going to ruin me anyway. It's going to separate me. That's what the old self separated for you from God. Now you're separated for him. Jesus has already said this when asked what the greatest commandment is, the Sadducees, Pharisees, and all the religious leaders were trying to trip him up, as they always did, and they never could do it. And they said, Lord, what's the greatest commandment? Come on, just give us one. What's the one big one? And he said to them, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the great and foremost commandment. Love God. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend the whole law and the prophets. Love God, love people. Mimic God's love. God's love for us needs to be returned in the same quantity, same quality of our love for him. God's love for the world needs to be reflected into the world. Love God, love people. Be imitators of God. Last one Paul says here is, imitate light. Walk as children of the light. Verses 7 and 8, therefore do not be partakers with them, the sons of disobedience, for you were formerly darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. And all throughout this, I couldn't help but think as I was reading this over and over again for the last couple weeks in prep for this morning that we're given this command to be imitators of God, to be, and yet then God says, be holy as I am holy. God's already holy, now we're commanded to be holy. And then he says love. We find that God is love. And then he gives us the command to love God, love people. And now he says that we're to be the light of the world. And 1 John 1:15 says, this is the message we have heard from him and announced to you, that God is light. So again, we're just mimicking, we're just imitating God in the world. That God is light and in him there is no darkness at all. Paul says, you were formerly darkness. Once upon a time, you were darkness. But God came into your life. And God's light shone through, and you understood the difference of light and darkness. And you reached out for God by faith through confession, repentance, asking for forgiveness. God came in and then bestowed light upon you, and you are now light. We're to imitate that light. Holy as God is holy, love as God loves, walk in the light as God is light. Verse 9 talks about fruit of the light. Fruit is the outcome of walking in light. This is what just naturally comes about, naturally is produced in our life as we are walking in the light. And he says goodness, righteousness, and truth, which goes right back to chapter 4, verse 24, where he said righteousness and holiness of truth. It's all tied together in this relationship that we have with God, this desire to live for him. And he ties the importance of the mind in again. He says, walk as children of light, trying to learn what is pleasing to the Lord. Look at verse 11. Do not participate in the unfruitful deeds of darkness, but instead even expose them. For it is disgraceful even to speak of the things which are done by them in secret. But all things become visible when they are exposed by the light, for everything that becomes visible is light. For this reason, he says, awake, sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Therefore, be careful how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of your time, because the days are evil. One thing that light does is it exposes what goes on in the darkness. A light bulb turned on can't sneak around in the dark. It eliminates the dark. Just talked about this last week in the Worldview Foundations class where, you know, it's that idea that have you ever tried, you know, in your refrigerator to see if the light really goes off? We just bought lights for our closets, and they're the kind that, you know, they're motion sensors, so you just, you know, wave your hand, the light comes on in the closet, and then after like 15 or 20 seconds of no movement, it goes off. So I shut the closet door, and then I looked. Yep, okay, it goes off. I still check almost every time just to see, did it? That's the light. We're to be the light that eliminates the darkness. If you are in the dark, you turn on the light. If you are in the light, you don't turn on the dark. You turn off the light. Now, put that into a spiritual language within our world. You are the light of the world. You are to live your life in such a way that when you walk into dark places, the light shines through. Darkness is exposed. The sin that is there is revealed because it's in contrast to the light. The exposing of darkness is not done by shouting on a street corner or posting on social media, but through a consistent lifestyle of holiness and love, all done based on the truth of God. It's a life of character, a life of integrity, a life of consistency. These were all signs we talked about in our small group of what to define maturity last week. Based on God's standard of morality, it's lived in contrast to the world's standard of survival of the fittest, might makes right. Do whatever it takes. Just living life different sometimes is the only preaching we need to do. St. Francis of Assisi says, preach the gospel at all times, and if necessary, use words. That our life should be that message. Our life should be that light that shines in the darkness. And again, this is a process of learning what is pleasing to the Lord, putting that on and living it out. Disciples are learners. We're students of Jesus. Eric has said it before, and I totally agree, 75 minutes on Sunday morning is not enough. You're going to go out into the world, and I'm going to guarantee you're going to be a pretty dim light if this is all you got. That's why our disciple-making leadership team is working diligently on providing opportunities for you to learn. for you to put in more than the 75 minutes. And I'm not saying this is all you've all. I know you're. There's many that are reading. There are many that are in. There are many. It's why we offer classes like the Worldview Foundations class to help us change our mind, to help us understand what God is thinking. It's why coming up we have the Alpha Marriage class. So your marriage mimics God's design. God has a design for your marriage. And if we live outside that design, we can't expect great things. We're offering a Bible 101 class because it's a new class that if you're new to this whole thing of reading the Bible, or if you just never really looked at the Bible as one whole big long story, this 7-week class on a Tuesday night coming up here after Easter is what you need to help learn, to help solidify who Jesus is. That's why we have small groups. Small groups are foundational to the process of disciple making. We have 14 current groups, the newest one starting today in about 28 minutes. Downstairs for the parents of middle school students. While the middle school students are meeting in their life groups from 11:30 to 12:30, we've got a group of parents that are going to meet for a small group as well. That's why we're looking constantly for new leaders. We would love to start new groups, especially Westfield, North Carmel area. If you live in that area and you want to find out more about how to be a leader of a group, step into that. We would love to train you, work with you. Because we know it's those groups, it's in those settings that life transformation happens. That doesn't always happen here. And isn't always going to happen at home in your prayer closet alone. We were built, designed for community. We were saved and placed in the body to function in the body. But it's up to each one of us to take advantage of all of these things that are provided. It's tough to walk in the light if we don't know what or where the flashlight is. It's tough to turn anything on if we don't know that it's there. There's a lot of stumbling around and bruised shins because we just don't know the truth. Folks, we have no reason to live in the shadows. We have every reason to stand and shine bright. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, he said, "You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden, nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven." We can sit back and complain about the way the world is, about all the sin that's running rampant, about all the life that's going on, the bad things that are happening. We can sit and we can complain about those, or we can shine. We can live a life that exposes the darkness. Christians are to be the change that we wish to see by reflecting Christ as the light of the world, through our life, through my disciplines, the way I live my life, the way I am set apart for God. Believers, you once were darkness, but now you are light. It's a contrast of the reality of life before with life now. And the world needs to see that light. They need to see that transformation that is ongoing. I'm going to have the worship team come up. I prayed all week on how to close this morning because we can't just leave the bar way high because we'll all walk out of here going, "I can't do that. I've tried that. That doesn't work." What do we do with all this information? Because this is all truth. It's all good stuff. But if the plan is to hear this sermon and walk out and just simply try harder, tomorrow morning I'm waking up and I'm going to be holy. I'm going to love better I'm going to be the light at my workplace. I'm going to be the light in my neighborhood. If that's the plan, then we've already missed it. Because I can't wake up and decide to be holy. I can't wake up and decide to love. I can't wake up and decide to be light. The problem with holiness is that it is unattainable for you and I. I might as well have preached the need to fly to the moon or swim the Atlantic. Paul reminded the Corinthians that there is no one righteous, not even one, that our righteousness, our holiness is like filthy rags. This is not a message where you listen and then go do all the things, because we can't. That's Paul's point. On our own, our attempts to be holy, our attempts to love, our attempts to be light is the old way of life. It's doing it on my own. It's doing it out of my strength, out of what I want, out of my abilities. That is what we left behind. Now what we need is found only in Jesus. Only through confession and repentance. I'm convinced that the best response to a sermon like this is confession. Lord, I'm not those things. I still have elements of the old way of life alive in me. And to bring them before Him. To begin that elimination of the old life. Rendering them useless, having God restore or take away and restore His life in us. Isaiah chapter 6, one of my favorite chapters, says Isaiah found himself, he was in the temple and he had a vision of the Lord high and seated on the throne, high and lifted up. His robe filled the entire temple and there were angels flowing all around him, singing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." And you would think, boy, being caught up in that, that would just be the most awesome thing to see that, to see God in His heaven and all the angels singing. And Isaiah's result was, "Woe is me. I, the prophet of God, am a man of unclean lips because I've been face to face with the holiness of God and my own sinfulness shines through." And he was broken. Realizing there's absolutely nothing I can do. I can't add anything to that. He was brought to his knees by his own lack of holiness, his own, the gap that was between his life and the holiness of God. Tozer, what is in my life that is unlike God and contrary to the holiness of God must be eliminated from my life. Holiness is not about doing all the things. It's about knowing we can't and bringing all of our mess to Jesus. Confessing that sin, confessing that shortness, receiving the forgiveness, receiving the healing, receiving the repaired soul. Then we're ready to walk out and live from that posture. And that's not a one and done. Sometimes for me, it's on the daily, moment by moment. Confession, repentance. This morning, I want to give you that opportunity. We're going to sing this final song. And I want you to hear God. I want you to bring all the stuff that needs to be eliminated. All the stuff that falls far short. And we've all got it, all right? None of us are more holy than the other. We're all same level sinners, and when Christ puts His righteousness on us, we're all the same level believer, saint. There's something in your life you've been struggling with. There's something in your life maybe you have given up on ever defeating. There's a darkness in your past that continues to creep its way in and defeat you. Today, no more. as we sing, you give it. You confess it. You believe that Jesus took it and eliminated it. Removes our sin as far as the east is from the west. Restores us. Puts his righteousness on us. That when God looks at us, he sees the righteousness of Christ. Because he is our go-between, our mediator. His life for my life. And I give my life for his. Father, this morning, I pray your Holy Spirit speak clearly. Father, that we might truly leave here different than we came in. Because we've been in your presence. We've been in the presence of holiness. And Father, we are a people of unclean lips that needs your touch, your forgiveness, your righteousness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This morning the prayer benches are open. I want to encourage you to use them. Come, spend time with the Lord. Just allow him to do what only he can do in your life.
Come to the altar. Somebody out there, say amen. Amen. All right, thank you. I am Brad. Oh, no, I'm not Brad. I am Sarah Harris, and we are here to talk to you today about a couple of events that are coming up. We are ready to get you fired up. The first thing is Ignite. Ignite Night, this Friday night, 6:30. If you are a middle schooler, if you are a high schooler, you need to be in this house Friday evening for Ignite Night. If you have a middle schooler, if you have a high schooler, you need to get them in this house this Friday night. Now, if you don't have a middle schooler and you don't have a high schooler, I'm going to tell you this. Starting last week, you should have been praying for a number. Anybody remember what that number was?
It wasn't that, sorry. 222.
222 students taking up the entire camp for Ignite this coming year, right? 222 is the number that you are bringing before the Lord every day between now and then. Ignite Night will get everybody fired up to be there this summer.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Let's do it. I love it. We do. Yes, we're revealing our new logo, and so it's going to be an awesome night. So it starts at 7 o'clock, so 7 to 9. You guys should be there. We're going to hang out. We're going to try to make it as Ignite-esque as possible, and so it's going to be awesome. You guys should join us and get fired up for the year. I am Sarah. Oh, darn it. I'm not that either. Oh, no, I'm Brad. And I am here. I'm talking about Missions Fest, or I've named it Mish Fest. So March 17th, 6:30 to 8:30, we're going to be here, and our desire is we want you guys to have a new understanding of missions. We want you guys to get excited about missions, about what God's doing in the world, and about what role you might play in missions. And so I know we have some fun ideas. We have some Olympic games going on, so I have to actually create a high school team. So high schoolers, we got to get excited about it because we have to defend our 3-on-3 tournament crown from Summer Bash. So yes, but we have some games planned, some fun things, and our goal is we just want you guys to see maybe even how God might use you in missions. So that's what we're excited about. So the next 2 weeks, Ignite Night this Friday, and then next Friday, March 17th, we have Missions Fest. Thank you.
Here is Paul's prayer for the Ephesian church, and it's our prayer as our benediction this morning. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with power through his Spirit in the inner man, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, and that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled up to the fullness of God. Amen. Amen. Have a great week.